The first speaker is Uwe Gunther from Dresden, and he will speak on the IR truncated PT symmetric IX cube model and its asymptotic spectral scaling graph. So we hope the post-lunch session will be very productive, and I invite Professor Gunther to deliver his lecture.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for having this conference here in Bangalore, this very beautiful, nice place. And my talk is about work which is almost finished, but not yet. So it's still to be polished the results a little bit and to be submitted. Nevertheless, I decided, okay, to present it to you. So it's about inferent truncated PT symmetric IX cube models and its asymptotic spectral scaling graph. I will briefly sketch the current situation, the state of the art, then give a brief motivation why to truncate this model to a box. Then I will briefly review the results of Bender and Jones from 2012 about the WKB approach for the real part of the spectrum of the model. Then I will give an impression about the concrete Stokes graphs for complex energies. Then I will, at some length, dwell on the minus IX model for pedagogical reasons, because one can learn there something about the hidden structures. And then I will discuss the scaling ansatz, asymptotic spectral scaling graphs, and present some analytical WKB results for complex spectral branches. Or the global picture of PT phase transitions and give a brief outlook. Okay, let's start with the current state of the art of the situation. So here in this PT community, it's clear that the IX cube model is the cornerstone or one of the benchmarks of the theory. So first results had been, quantum mechanical results had been obtained by Bessels and Chin-Suskin, as it's well known, in the mid of the 90s, numerical indications that the spectrum of this corresponding operator is real. Then Carl Bender and Stefan Böttcher started the PT business in 98. In 2001, in a collaboration with Michael Berry, Meisinger, Savage, and Simsek, they derived WKB results for the eigenvalues of general IX to the nth models. Then Patrick Doré, Claire Dunning, and Roberto Taddeo and Shin, they proved the reality and the geometric simplicity of the eigenvalues of this model based on monotomy considerations, beta ansatz technique, spectral determinants, and so on. Then it was a little bit later, it was proven that the eigenvalues are also algebraic simple. It means one has no Jordan blocks for the model over the whole real line. And then, only some years later, Peter Siegel and David Grecherik had a more attentive view on this model class, and they found that over the real line, the eigenfunctions are forming a complete set, but they do not form a re-spaces. This was made more precise a year later by Henri, who showed that the spectral projectors for these eigenvalues are diverging, so that the eigenfunctions do even not form a basis at all. A nice review paper concerning pseudospectral techniques for non-Hamiltonian Hamiltonians in quantum mechanical setups is presented by David Grecherik, Peter Siegel, Miloš Tata, and Viola in the review paper in 2014, just as reference. Okay, these are the main part, the last works are hard operator theoretical results. And of course, it would be nice to get also some additional physical intuition, what might be the situation with these models. In order to tackle these problems, one can learn just from quantum field theory, just put all the model in a box, try to study the model in the box, and afterwards try to make an infrared completion of the model. It means push the limits to infinity and to see how the possible singularities emerge and how they survive and what might be the physics of all this picture. Concerning this projector norms, when one has this behavior here, it simply means that here one has eigenvectors, dual bi-orthogonal eigenvectors. You know, in this setup, one is just forming their norm and the inner product of both of them. So one has the several options. Either one can fix this bi-orthogonal inner product to unity, then the norms will blow up of these vectors. Or one can fix these norms and then we'll immediately see this, this inner product will become isotropic, tending to zero. And this is the typical behavior which can also be found in matrix models. This is L2, and this is the general relation is also holding for any matrix model, and we studied these things together with Ingrid Rotter and Boris Samsonov in 2007. There we are considering so-called phase rigidity, which was coming from other physical models, and one has the same relationship here by orthogonal inner product and the usual Hermitian inner product, and this one easily checks that just the inverse of this, so close to an exceptional point, and once approaching this exceptional point, this phase rigidity is tending to zero, or this projector norm is tending to infinity. So from the paper of Carl Bender and Hugh Jones from 2012 of the IX cube model over an interval, it was clear that these models have countable set of exceptional points in them. So why not use this analogy to a quantum field theory? Usually in a QFT, in order to handle singularities, one can either use an ultraviolet cutoff, just putting the model on a lattice with a finite lattice spacing A, or if one has additional inferent singularities, just use an infrared truncation. So compactify the space, for instance, on a large torus, or truncate the model and put it in a box of large size L. So we will use the second method here. Such infrared divergences are typically occurring, for instance, in physical models where one has a large number of very soft photons. And in this interplay, in order to arrive at a finite energy, one is playing with large numbers here, and it might well be that this IX cube model, due to the fact that it's actually can be also related to a conformal field theory and a field theory setup, that these soft modes might play a crucial role in all this underlying physics of this model. So the usual business in this infrared truncation approach is first truncate a model, do the calculations, look what you are getting, and afterwards consider the limit to see how singularities are emerging, how to control them, and in this way, the rough idea is, okay, why not try this approach just to this IX cube model and try to gain some physical intuition, complementary to the hard operator theory results, and maybe in this way to get some better and deeper understanding of these specific PTs and matrix setups. Okay, first few comments about the results of Carl Bender and Hugh Jones from 2012. They considered this model just on an interval from minus one to one on the real axis, used the WKP approach, and they were focusing on the real part of the spectrum. So what they were doing was just looking at the Stokes graph of such AX cube models. Typically, they have such a form. One has three turning points. These are the turning points here. Yeah, these terms are vanishing here under the square root. So the red lines are the anti-Stokes lines, where the solutions are mostly oscillating up to some inverse factors. And the green lines are Stokes lines, where the fastest decay or blow up. So one has typically such a picture. And it might be that this picture might somehow help in studying the spectral problem for this truncated IX cube model. So what were they doing? They were first just deforming the interval to a path into the complex plane, passing through these two lower turning points, just considering zero order or leading WKB approximation along this path. The important input was that this path was not only through turning points, but also PT symmetric. It's important because, we will see it later, for this formula, which was the main formula obtained by Carl Bender and Hugh Jones, the essential role is played also by this imaginary component here, which is just on the path segment from one of the endpoints of the path where the Dirichlet conditions are fixed to one of the turning points. The other, so one has this formula here. IT is the total integral along all the path. Once it's PT symmetric, it's real. Also, one has this PT symmetric path segment between the turning points. It's IM. And this imaginary component of the path of the wave function over the path segment from the endpoints to the turning point. This was their result, and they did a numerical study, found a new coincidence with numerical results. Everything was fine. So, and what might be learned if you would try to go to complex eigenvalues? In this case, all these Stokes graphs are strongly deforming. For instance, if you are taking here for an energy value just as a sample, IP over 20, you have a slight deformation of this original Stokes graph. Here we have this simple bridge between the two exceptional points. And this bridge is doubling, obviously, by lines, so it's splitting here. Stokes graph is strongly deforming. If you are taking a higher argument here, then this deformation is becoming much stronger. So the next fact is that we can see that is, of course, asymmetric with regard to the x axis and under complex conjugation, we will see that these pictures, these Stokes graphs, are reflection symmetric with regard to the imaginary axis. So we have this picture for these positive arguments here, and we have side inverted pictures for negative arguments. So the PT symmetry is manifest also in these Stokes graphs, of course. And the question is, can we draw some benefit from these Stokes graph pictures? Okay, so for this purpose, we can first consider a more well solvable model, minus IX model, which is solvable in terms of area functions. Just consider the Hamiltonian with positive coupling here, just for definiteness. I truncate the model considered over a real interval, putting Dirichlet boundary conditions. So the solutions will be given by area functions. So we briefly summarized the basic results or features of the solutions of the area functions. So we have these three types of possible solutions, which are linearly independent. It's clear that two of them will produce the third one. With this argument here, it's a kind of functional Galois relation, as we will see. So the relevant properties are that the area functions, these solutions are entire functions, are single valued on the complex plane, on the finite complex plane, not at infinity. One has this connection formula between them. And a zero of order leading WKB approximation in which we will work. So the important thing here is, okay, one can consider just a single sheet. This function, this is two-sheeted due to this 3/2 power here. Only this asymptotic approximation, it is valid for large Z components. And this approximation is valid in this on this sheet up to the vicinity of this cut here on the negative real axis. On the cut, the above and the lower contributions are superposing, and one is getting an oscillating solution in the highest order approximation. This approximation is a good approximation, but it's not an asymptotic approximation because the zeros are not reproduced here, and they are not coinciding with the zeros of the area function. For more accurate calculations, one has to use a higher order Poincaré type asymptotic approximation, or even use Michael Berry's approach of super and hyper asymptotic techniques. But here, for the beginning, we will just use zero of order WKB techniques. An additional important feature is that here in this shaded area, one in this Stokes sector, this asymptotics has decaying behavior. Here it has a blowing up diverging behavior. And on these anti-Stokes lines, one has oscillating type behavior up to these prefactors, of course. So we will use, we will make heavy use of these properties. So we are just transforming the original Eigenwähler problem to the area type equation. It's trivial, so we have these solutions, any of those, in terms of any of those area functions, boundary conditions, characteristic equation, a secular equation. For a very specific ansatz, this was studied by Stjopin from Moscow. The calculations were highly non-trivial, but the result was extremely simple. So one has actually, one has a very simple scaling graph underlying this model. All the eigenvalues are located on this rotated Y graph. So one has these straight line segments, just these scaled components, and all they are living here and moving depending on the scaling. They are moving on this spectral graph here. We analyzed this picture in a different context already in 2005. And here I will present some analytical results. Because once this picture is very simple, so it's one can conjecture that there might be some very simple underlying mechanism to produce this picture. So we are assuming that there might exist some kind of strong simplification hypothesis. For this purpose, we leave these basis functions which are entering the secular equations still open. And the assumption is, could it be that for some very specific combination of these chosen functions here, it might hold, we are just transforming in this way, that one of these components is just decaying, the other might be of order one. And this component, for instance, is blowing up, so that actually all what is remaining is just the zeros of some of these, of one of these array functions. Could this be possible? So in order to test this, we are using it, we are doing it just explicitly. So we are just in these new coordinates, in these set coordinates, which are the coordinates of the array function. We are just representing the boundary conditions in the scaled energy. So we have the scaled energy, the scale, purely real scale factor here, which will not change the graph picture. Actually, it will only blow up or shrink it. And the next important thing is just the difference of them, it's just the mapped interval on which the problem is living, and it's just rotated in the complex plane where the scaling is entering here. When we are using the connection formula, just plugging in it into these secular equations, we are seeing that we have three types of equivalent representations. In terms of this array function pair, another one with this mu cube, and finally mu and mu cube. So we have three representations, and we have in each of these representations, we have four type of arguments of array functions. So we are just testing all these 12 cases explicitly. One can just write down these arguments, assuming that the first argument here is just on the negative real axis, so that it will produce the zeros, and look what will happen if we are entering the other arguments. So there, once we have this ray here given, all the other rays combinations are immediately also given, and we are just depicting them in the complex plane. What we are getting is such a picture. We have this argument, for instance, on the negative real axis, parallel to this, is set minus, which is shifted in one or the another direction. And then we have the other components, which are either parallel to this anti-Stokes line, on this anti-Stokes line and parallel to it, or to the other one. And now we can check whether these divergent and decaying solutions are compatible with this condition here. And it turns out that only two of those combinations are producing this highly simplified result. So by unfortunate, Stjopin was using not those combinations, but different ones, and his calculations were extremely complicated. When one is just using these assumptions, everything becomes extremely simple. So one's just plugging this in, one is seeing that one has here in zero order approximation this kind of condition here. What finally gives here is Maslow term and just the zeros living defined all by this coordinates here. These are the segments, and one is seeing that the endpoints until one has this negative real axis, this ray along this axis, and the relevant configurations are belonging only to this small interval, this interval, this and this, and this will cut also this ray, producing an equivalent segment only here, and the same on these other Stokes, anti-Stokes lines. So, and this endpoint is just given by this relation here. When one is plugging this into this scaling graph segments, one is getting these effective energies in this form here. So from I minus I, and then just downward, upward, and here some scaling and plus the zeros of the array function. The endpoint is mapped just to real eigenvalue. These are just the eigenvalues here by the zeros of the array function given, and we are just had reproduced these segments here. Everything works very nicely, very simple, without strong efforts. we may immediately, once we have this relation here, just look what's happening in the case of an infrared completion. So if you are taking the interval to infinity, what's happening is we can just multiply this the scaling graph by this corresponding prefactor. What we are getting is this relation here, and we are seeing that the modulus of these all these eigenvalues are shifting to infinity. So we are getting an empty, all this graph is blowing up to infinity, leaving here an empty region. This is just the empty spectrum derived by operator theoretic methods in 78 by Herbst, the well-known result. Okay, once we had these results, let's try to understand them in more detail. So we have just the area function. When we are mapping this found picture back into the x-plane of the original coordinates, or in the rescaled coordinates, we have these coordinates here. What we are seeing is that this area function is the corresponding subdominant sector, Stokes sector, is located here in this region. These are the dominant ones. Here's the cut along this line. And all the eigenvalues which are related to the turning point are moving on this line here, up or down, opening this subdominant Stokes wedge to more higher extent or closing it. And what one is seeing is this path, if you are starting the path just at one of these boundary points, assuming that we have this zero of the area function just located here, or zero of the sine function, then we can use the path along this negative real axis of the area function up to the turning point, entering the subdominant Stokes wedge and connecting the path in this subdominant Stokes wedge to the other endpoint. And due to this WKP approximation, this boundary condition here is fulfilled to much higher order than to the used approximation. So the boundary condition, we have one exact boundary condition and one asymptotic one. And this graph is, a spectral graph is reproduced. The mechanism is when we are reaching this point here, it's clear that this subdominant wedge is moving up here this way. And it's also clear simultaneously the other endpoint is moving up to this boundary. And if you would, we are moving farther away, this endpoint would be in the dominant Stokes wedge, and it's impossible to fulfill the boundary conditions. So this is just the reason that we have only these finite segments, and this point here corresponds to the point to the endpoint of these complex branches where the real energy where they are meeting. This is the underlying mechanism. We will use this mechanism also for the IXQ model. This is the basic trick that we will use. So just to reproduce the eigenvalue conditions, we had this specific parameter, which for the negative real line, S is chosen real and positive. We have the WKP approximation in the area function, just representing in this way from the turning point to the boundary point. We have just this WQP term and the corresponding boundary condition, Dirichlet boundary condition is to be fulfilled exactly by this condition, what gives finally quantization condition with this Maslow's term here. Just to mention that these anti-Stokes lines, they are also considered in mathematics, also by Koncevich and so on for quantum gravity models, and so-called Strabel graphs. These are just same objects as anti-Stokes lines. These are the horizontal lines of the quadratic differential. One is considering such things. So one is just getting this potential here argument zero, and then there's vertical ones. These are just the Stokes lines of highest decay, and in other contexts, these things are also used. Just to consider the real eigenvalues of the model, we use a, which should be located on this real interval here. We are just plugging in real eigenvalues, assuming that they are on this arrays here. And this means that in the coordinates of the area function, of the effective coordinates, we have this ray configurations here. So this means for these real eigenvalues, these puffs in these coordinates are relevant, these dashed lines here. So we have pairwise two in the subdominant region sector, Stokes sector, and two parallel ones in the dominant one, and here just inverted complex conjugated. But it's hidden in this picture here. It's not obvious from this picture here, this view and so on. So one sees this only from the graphs. Just plugging these things in, one is getting, starting from this secular equation, plugging it in, one is seeing that one has these integrals here, fitting them together, we are just getting the usual integral for the eigenvalues over the interval, but for complex potential. And it's, so we have the usual quantization condition, and this integral is of course real because the puff is PT symmetric, so only the real component is singled out. Okay, this was one ingredient of the consideration. Next one is, we were seeing that we have this scaling splitting. So we can just extract, just now going to the IX cube model, extract the interval and the coupling. We have just this prefactor, scaling prefactor, and this effective energy. So what we are doing, we are just considering this submodel here, and the scaling is just an additional ingredient, but it's geometrically irrelevant. We have the two special cases, an almost empty box. It means we can fix, for instance, some energy eigenvalue, the box length, and we are switching off the potential. It's clear that we have an empty box, and we are reproducing in this scaling here. Once it's this way, it's diverging. So empty box means that the turning points will also blow up to infinity. The other case is in the infrared completion. Let's also fix, for instance, energy, coupling, and blow up the box. This means that these energy eigenvalues are, of course, tending to zero. And our picture is, it's a kind of special focus on the exceptional point region via this consideration. So again, for the real eigenvalues, let's look at this effective scaling graphs. So we have all, for all real eigenvalues, they are form invariant, these Stokes graphs. These are only the anti-Stokes lines here considered, so that they are just scaling. Once we are fixing boundary conditions in this model, minus one and one, at boundary points where the Dirichlet boundary conditions should be fulfilled, and we are using the same assumption for the puffs. This means we will have, for instance, for these effective energies, which are smaller than the critical ones, we will have this segment here between the turning points, it will stay. And then we will have a puff which is not coinciding with the Stokes, anti-Stokes line. So it will either be decaying or blowing up. And vice versa for higher energy values, which are greater than this critical one, we will live on the other side of this anti-Stokes line here. And this means that in this formula here, of Carl Bender and Hugh Jones, we have a smooth regime change, not a political one, a mathematical one. So it means what we are seeing here is we have this on the just on the anti-Stokes lines, and this means once we are considering asymptotic cases, this imaginary part will be very large for certain regimes. It means if it's positive, this component will define the spectrum mainly. In the opposite case, we will have this case. And we are seeing, okay, that we are just reproducing earlier results by Carl Bender and Michael Berry for these ones here, and the usual box results in the other case outside. Everything is fine. So this means we can immediately identify a dominance or subdominance of the corresponding regions here between these Stokes lines. So one is dominant, subdominant, and vice versa. For the transition regime, just vanishing imaginary part, we can just represent this, and we have just a splitting of those graphs in two segments. One along this segment, and this the other one composed, and vice versa. So we have the splitting here, breakup of the Stokes diagram. And we would like to use this now for the WKB analysis of the complex spectral branches. So what we are seeing here, we can just again put Dirichlet boundary conditions on one of the side points and assume that we have on this small segment here area function type behavior like on the negative real axis, and here this line connecting then in a subdominant Stokes sector and vice versa. Then it will close and we will have a phase transition. So this structural conjecture is used. We can just plug it in for this IX cube model. Dirichlet boundary conditions, Maslow term again, area function type behavior, splitting in a prefactor scaling, prefactor and scaling graph, which should be purely real. And the task is, okay, we know that this is purely real, the energies are somehow complex, and the task is to find the curve in the energy space, which is just producing this integral as real. This can be solved by just by differentiating. One is getting a differential equation with, which can be solved singular at the initial point. We are choosing exceptional point at the boundary point, doing a Poisson expansion. We can choose appropriate boundary conditions for numerical integration. And what we are getting is just this line in the complex plane. And corresponding to these colors here, we have the corresponding anti-Stokes lines here. You have this family, which is just filling this region here. Consideration, some details again. We are seeing shooting is going from the turning points, and we are exactly matching here the boundary condition. Some, now we can compare this with earlier numerical investigations, just by Sturm-Liouville Eigenvalue-Sorvel by shooting method. So we have just for the IX cube model over the interval, this is just L, the length, it's B here. We have the spectrum, this is the real part. Merging eigenvalues and turning to the complex branch. Here multiplied by the square of the box length, we are seeing that we have almost the box spectrum here. And then it's blowing up. And if you are matching all this, just rescaling this imaginary complex part, we have this curve here. Here in the vicinity of the phase transition for all these branches. So all these branches that we were seeing here in this picture, they are mapping on this single scaling graph. They're all together here. All these branches and the whole spectrum will map on this single scaling graph, which will encode the basic spectral dynamics of this model. And we can just compare to the analytical result. What we are having here is the green one is the analytical solution of this differential equation here compared to the results of the solver. And it's clear that the deviation close to this exceptional point region here is due to higher order corrections. And the point is that this picture can be used. We have now, we are knowing that the IX cube model on the real line is just sitting completely on this lower segment here. And what, when one is going with the counting parameters of the eigenfunction to infinity, one is just approaching this phase transition region here, and so it's not a surprise that the spectral projectors are diverging and so on. So we are just reaching an exceptional point, which is encoding very nicely in the simple picture here at infinity. And by this picture, we can rescale it in a kind of a spectral Penrose diagram, which is something similar here. These infinities are put on a finite distance, and we can hopefully control them in future. So consider this EP mechanism, selection rules, and higher order potentials. Thank you.
Questions?
This criticism of using operator methods was based on these norms I asked about, which were in L2. But if you think about IX cubed as a model which is a unitary model in quantum mechanics, so you must take into consideration the metric. And then, of course, the metric doesn't exist.
Yeah, sure.
By this paper by Krejcik and Siegel. So the question is, what's the area of application of this model, which is not quantum mechanical model?
No, this is the exciting point. It's the fantastic model. This is not, it's not destroying it. What we were seeing is actually that all this model, this IX cube model, it's from field theory, it's just a conformal field theory, IX cube conformal, non-unitary conformal field theory, exactly solvable with S matrix, with bound states in this model. So most likely this bound state will somehow be reflected in this quantum mechanical setup, most likely. And additionally, once we have a conformal field theory, having the mapping to quantum mechanics in conformal field theory, we have all this business with this large number of soft modes, infrared truncation and all these things. So it might make sense just to look at those models and look for structural parallels, just as a quantum mechanical toy model for these setups. And there should be very strong parallels, I'm more or less convinced. And that is extremely exciting. So it's only the starting point. And okay, thank you.
Is there any other question? If not, let's thank Professor Uwe Gunther once again.